Hello everyone and welcome back to Scandinavian Design 101. I'm Sanna.
I'm Andreas and we're two Swedes and we love design. And today we're going to talk about the one and only Lisa Larson, the hugely popular Swedish ceramicist and her adorable, friendly looking figurines.
Yeah, and let's start. Lisa Larson, born Lisa Alhage, was born in southern Småland in 1931, but the family soon moved to a small community in Skåne called Killeberg. Her father was running a sawmill and was also a court official in the town of Växjö. More than that, he was an art and antique lover, and that led to a home filled with artworks. Lisa got so inspired by all of this creativity that she wanted to become an artist herself. From a young age, she was always drawing or carving wooden figures. Remember, her father had a sawmill, so there was a lot of wood around. Close to the Larson family home, a teacher from the technical school in Gothenburg rented a summer house. He got to see Lisa's figures and was really impressed and encouraged her to apply to the art school in Gothenburg, nowadays called the School of Design, Arts and Crafts. And so she did, but she didn't know which line of study she should be in. So the principal Åke Hult placed her in the ceramics department, although Lisa wanted to become a fashion designer like her sister. Her tutor was the Finnish-Swedish ceramicist Kurt Ekholm, known from the Arabia porcelain factory. And as soon as she began working with clay, she knew she was in the right place. She sat by the potter's wheel long into the evenings and loved it. A few years later, she married another artist, Gunnar Larson, and therefore Lisa Larson.
Yeah.
After 5 years of studies in 1954, she was looking forward to earning a living as a free, independent ceramicist with her own workshop. However, a short time before her graduation, her tutor, Kurt Ekholm, had sent in some of her works to a competition between the art schools in Scandinavia. One jury member was Stig Lindberg, artistic director of Gustavsberg porcelain factory. He was very intrigued by Lisa's submissions. One vase took second prize, and shortly after the competition, he wrote her a letter. In the letter, he invited her to come and work for him on a one-year trial basis in the factory in Gustavsberg. Lisa, who was newly wed, was uncertain. They had just moved to a big apartment in Gothenburg with room for her and her husband to be creative. But Lindberg promised to find a suitable living situation in Gustavsberg, so she accepted. They didn't know that it would be a small room and kitchenette with a shower within walking distance.
Okay, it doesn't look very fancy, sound very fancy. Lisa started her career in the golden years of Swedish design. And Swedish crafts were developing in two different ways. One was refined with sophisticated expression, whilst the other one was rustic, robust with more primitive look. And many young artists were sick of the elegant shapes and went the other way. And one of them was, of course, Lisa Larson. And Lisa found inspiration from old traditional ceramics and from primitive ceramics found at the Ethnographic Museum in Stockholm. At the start of the 50s, the Gustavsberg porcelain factory was regarded very successful and modern, designing both tableware and art items. A lot of recognized artists were working there, for example, Wilhelm Kåge, the former artistic director who played a big part in the studio, the famous art department which he had started already in 1942. But also, for example, Bernt Friberg and Karin Björkqvist. With Lisa, four other candidates started their trial year in 1954, and they were allowed to create freely and got a modest salary. And Stig
Lindberg... That's a small one.
Yeah, quite small one. Mm-hmm. Stig Lindberg has described it like this. My intention is to discover the gifts and talents of these young people and then employ the best of them in the factory. Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah.
And Lisa has described her first year at Gustavsberg as her university, with Stig Lindberg as a mentor. She discovered materials like stoneware and chamotte. And during her studies, she mostly used earthenware, a clay that becomes reddish yellow after burning. I think you've seen it. It's quite porous and has to be glazed to be waterproof. Stoneware, on the other hand, is a strong ceramic material consisting silica. And silica makes it waterproof when burned in high temperature. And lastly, chamotte, which contains crushed oven-proof ceramics mixed with the stoneware clay. And after firing, it looks grained and rustic. A good thing with chamotte is that it doesn't shrink as much as other clays when burned.
One day, Lisa made a cat figure with its tail in the air. And Lindberg was impressed and wanted it to be in serial production. So this rough, charming cat in dark brown chamotte with stripes on the back and painted face became her first mass-produced figure. The cat was the start of a whole series of animal figures called Lilla Sue, or Little Sue. And it included two more cats, a dog, a fox, a horse, and a bison of all animals.
Strange.
Yeah. 2 years after that, the series Stora Sue, Big Sue, came out, including a giraffe, a zebra, a polar bear, a hippopotamus, a cat, and a moose. We have the giraffe, and it's really fun and big.
Yeah.
In 1958, she got her big breakthrough with the series ABC Girls. These five powerful female figures sold very well and captured the hearts of the Swedish people. They were inspired by the famous fertility goddess Venus of Willendorf from around 25,000 BC. And these voluptuous forms have since become a signature of Lisa. They sold in large numbers and secured jobs for the young women who painted them. Lisa never received any royalties, instead a modest salary, like most other women in Sweden during this time. And she also didn't get any free samples of the items she herself had created. No, she had to buy them.
Oh.
This was in the contract for all of the artists.
Yeah, it's strange. You won't get any free samples.
Even though you did it.
Yeah. After a trial year, Lisa was hired for full time and was given her own workshop in the same building as the art department studio. And her creativity often resulted in her works being put in production, for example, the So series, as we talked about earlier, and also Stina with Cat, made in 1957, was a huge success. And she made a huge lot of items in the 50s, not just figurines, but also, for example, vases with carved design. And she collaborated with a skilled potter who helped her make vases and bowls she later decorated.
The 60s was a great time for Lisa. She made many popular collections, for example, Larsons Unga, the Larson Kids, which were inspired by her own kids, Johanna, Mattias, and Andreas. Very popular Swedish name.
Very popular.
And also Africa, which featured African animals, including a lion, an elephant, a tiger, and a mule. Is that an African...
I don't really, perhaps.
I don't know. In 1967, she made one of my absolute favorite figures, Pippi Longstocking, the very loved Astrid Lindgren character with the horizontal pigtails. It was difficult to produce, so it was only made in small numbers. Because of that, Pippi is today very sought after and expensive, especially if it comes in the original bed-shaped box made by Lisa's husband Gunnar Larsson. You all know that Pippi slept with her feet on the pillow, right? She does that even in this one. It's awesome. In the 60s, it was very trendy to decorate open fireplaces with ceramic wall plaques. So Lisa did a number of them, many with the animal motifs, but also, for example, biskopar, bishops. Yeah. Like why? They're very boring.
Yeah.
One of her...
most boring things that you make. Boring things.
Also, tea drinking got trendy in the 60s, so she designed a teacup, Josephine, and a tea set, Matilda. In 1962, Lisa held her first solo exhibition at NK, Sweden's most exclusive department store. She showed a lot of unique Chamotte items, for example, vases, dishes, bowls, plaques, and the press both praised and criticized it.
The 70s was a difficult time for Swedish industries, not least porcelain factories. They all had a hard time competing with the new imported goods that were flooding the country from abroad. At the same time, the general interest in Swedish arts and crafts decreased. At Gustavsberg, this crisis was notable, but Lisa managed to design several successful figurines during this time. She was especially popular in Germany, so a lot of her objects were actually exported. And one of her biggest sellers in the 70s was a piggy bank depicting the finance minister Gunnar Sträng. And the piggy bank had no hole in the bottom, making it impossible to empty. And Lise explained this by saying, Gunnar Sträng always keeps everything he gets.
That is funny.
Another big seller was the series All Världens Barn, The Children of the World, produced in around 100,000 copies a year, and part of the profit went to UNICEF, United Nations Children's Fund. And also the series Utrotningshotade Djur, Endangered Species, made in collaboration with the World Wildlife Fund, was very successful. And it consists of, among other, a very cute lynx, otter, and hedgehog.
So cute.
I love her animals.
Yeah, they're so cute.
The consumers also loved cute and chubby children, so Lisa made the series Advent, consisting of child figurines. Some of them were candle holders. Mm. And these Christmas decorations are still being produced, actually.
Yeah.
And many of her unique stoneware works during this time shows modern women, some of them rising from bathtubs and some sitting and others standing. But if you see one, you immediately recognize them as a Lisa Larsson creation. Yeah.
At the end of the 70s, things were bad at the Gustavsberg porcelain factory and the workers felt it. Lisa felt that it was time for her to move on and leave the factory she had worked at for half her life. She decided to try her luck as a freelancer and left Gustavsberg in 1980. Both Lisa and her husband Gunnar had studios, and it didn't take long for Lisa to get commissions, not only from Swedish businesses, but also Danish and German. She was also invited to do an exhibition at the Seibu department store in Tokyo in 1981. Everything she showed there were sold.
Yeah. In 1993, the Gustavsberg porcelain factory was finally shut down, and two of Lisa's former colleagues, Franco Nicolosi and Siv Solin, reached out to Lisa, and sometime after that, the three started keramikstudion Gustavsberg, the ceramic studio Gustavsberg. And the company mostly produced Lisa's designs, and the majority of them were sold to Japan. And the company still exists today, and even though Lisa is no longer part owner, they still produce her designs. In 2000, for example, Keramikstudion launched Vänner, Friends, and this shows big dogs seeking comfort in their in the arms of their owners.
I love this.
It's extremely cute.
Oh.
It was cast and painted in a limited edition of 600, and they are since long sold out, but you can find them on the secondhand market. The company not only produced new figurines, but also many of her earlier designs. And this is interesting to note, because many collectors today are looking for the old figurines and not the re-editions by Keramikstudion. But if you don't care, you can buy the a bit newer ones for less money. So that's a good thing, I think.
Since the early 2000s, she has been hugely popular in Japan. She's held many exhibitions throughout the country. She's designed series of figures for the Japanese market. She's collaborated with many Japanese companies, and with that she had a lot of visits from Japanese retailers, gallery owners, journalists, and photographers. Lisa is still active today at 89 years old and has said that, "I don't have time to retire. Creating keeps me young."
Yeah.
And to end this video, I think we should say our favorite Lisa yes. Larsson figures. And my personal favorite is the Kennel series. Oh. I love dogs, but I especially love the large bulldog she made in 1972. it's like this.
Yeah, it's huge. Oh. And it's very
so
cute.
So cool. I love it.
Yeah. And my favorite is... It's not that cute, but it's the traffic range produced for only 3 years in the early 1970s. And it consists of 6 different figurines. And my favorite is the colorful hot air balloon in this series.
That's cool too.
But the strange thing is it's also a whale and an elephant.
Yeah.
And the elephant, okay, it's an elephant with someone riding it.
Yeah.
But the whale, and then it's someone in the belly of the whale. But I mean, that's not
amazing.
Really traffic, but it's
just
fun.
Just love her. So creative.
Yeah. And thanks a lot for watching.
Yeah.
And if you like this video,
please click thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already.
Yeah, and follow us on Instagram. We are called Scandinavian Design 101.
Yeah, thank you for watching.
Thank you.